Hello, my dear 10th standard children. Hope you all fine at home. Stay home, stay safe. I'm happy to welcome you to this video session. Today's session, we are going to see Unit 9 Solution Lesson. Let's go for the video session. Hello, children. Today, we are going to see a solution lesson. In this solution lesson, the learning objects are the definition of solution, types of solution, analyzing the factors influencing the solubility and various modes of expression and concentration of the solution, solubility of solute in solvent, hydrated salt and hydrous salts, distinguish between the deliquescent and hydroscopic substances. These are the learning objects we are going to see in solution lesson. We have learned more mixtures in our lower classes, isn't it? Most of the substances that we are encounter in our daily life are mixture of two more substances. The substances present in a mixture may exist one or more physical state. For example, we are burning the wood. What would happen? It will release the smoke and we will get the solid carbon. So it is a mixture. In some other mixture also, they will have a component is separated easily. For example, in two mixture, one contains salt, another contains water, one contains sugar, another contains water. So this is a salt solution and a sugar solution is also called as a mixtures. In solution, we will have two types of solution. One is homogeneous mixture, another one is heterogeneous mixture. What is mean by homogeneous mixture? Two or more things coming together to that you cannot see the differences. I'll be telling you one example. You can take 2 spoons of sugar or salt. You can mix in a glass of water. What will happen? The salt or sugar dissolve in water, isn't it? So, it dissolves in water to form a homogeneous mixture. This kind of mixture is called as a homogeneous mixture. Sometimes, this kind of homogeneous mixture are termed as a solution. Heterogeneous mixture. It is the second type of mixture is a heterogeneous mixture. We will be having one more example of this heterogeneous mixture. So, take 2 spoons of sand and 1 glass of water. You can add the 2 spoons of sand in 1 glass of water and mix. What will happen? The sand will be remain, it does not dissolve in water. It can be separated by the process of filtration only. So, it cannot be dissolved. So, it is a heterogeneous mixture. So, homogeneous is a salt and water example and heterogeneous mixture, sand and water is the example. Now you can able to understand what is mean by homogeneous and what is mean by heterogeneous. Solutions in day-to-day life. Did you know solutions are involved in day-to-day life? Yes. We cannot imagine an earth without sea water, isn't it? Sea water is a mixture. So it will have many dissolved salts. Another example I am giving is air. It is a mixture of gases. You can see nitrogen, oxygen, carbon dioxide. These are the mixture of gases in the atmospheric air. All the life forms on the earth are associated with solution. Plants take solution of nutrition for their growth from the soil. Most of the liquids found in the human body, including blood, lymph, urine, are also solution. Day-to-day human activities like washing, cooking, cleaning and few more activities are involved in the formation of solution with water. Similarly, when we drink, we take for example like fruit juice, aerated drinks, tea, coffee, etc. are also called as a solution. Therefore, ability of water to form a solution is responsible for sustainable of life. Components of solution. What is mean by components of solution? We know that solution is a homogeneous mixture of two or more substances, isn't it? In solution, component which is present, that is lesser amount, is called solute. The lesser amount means by weight, okay? And the component which is in larger amount by weight, it is called solvent. So, you can take a solution, for example, I told you homogeneous or heterogeneous. In homogeneous mixture, you have to take a salt solution or sugar solution, isn't it? The glass of water is weigh more when compared to only 2 spoons of sugar. The solute get distributed uniformly throughout the solvent. So, solvent is the water and sugar is the solute. So, lesser amount is always mean by the solute and the larger amount is always mean by the solvent. So, solvent acts as a dissolving medium in a solution. This process uniformly distributes the solute into the solvent is called dissolution. So, solute plus solvent, which gives you as a solution. A solution must be the least be consisting of two components, that is the solute and solvent. When the solution is made up of one solute and one solvent, it is called as a binary solution. Copper sulfate crystal to the water, it dissolves water forming solution of copper sulfate. Sodium copper sulfate crystal to a water, it dissolves in water forming a solution of copper sulfate, which is shown in the diagram. Now we are going to see the formation of copper sulfate solution. Adding the copper sulfate crystal to water, it dissolves in water forming the copper sulfate solution. It contains two components, isn't it? One solution is a and one solvent. One solute is copper sulfate. Its one solvent is water. Copper sulfate, it is also called as a copper sulfate solution. It is also called as a binary solution. Solution may contain more than two components. For example, if salt and sugar is added in the water, not a salt solution, it's not a sugar solution, both salt, water and sugar. It will be dissolving water, isn't it? Two solutes are dissolved in one solvent. Such kind of solution is contained as a tetanary solution. So, binary solution is one solute, one solvent. Tetanary solution will be the two solute and one solvent. Formation of solution. The solute plus solvent which gives solution. You have a detailed description in the images. The solute solvent which mix together is becomes as a solution. The more to know you have, all the solution are mixture, but all the mixtures are not solutions. Types of solution. Based on the physical state of a solute and a solution, the types may be varied in the solution. We know that substances normally exist in the three physical states. One is solid, liquid, gas. In binary solution, both the solute and the solvent may exist in any of these states. But the solvent constitutes major part of the solution. Its physical state is a primary factor which determines and characteristics of the solution. Therefore, there are the many types of binary solution. Some of the example I gave here, solute, solvent, an example. Liquid gas is a water in oxygen. Solid gas, iron vapor in air. Gas, liquid, carbonated water. And liquid, alcohol in water. Solid, liquid, aqueous sodium chloride solution. Gas, solid. Hydrogen in palladium, liquid solid, mineral oil in paraffin. Solid solid is a gold silver mixture. Already we seen it's based on the type of physical state of solute and the solvent, whether it is a solid or liquid or gas. Now we are going to see the based on the type of the solvent. There are two types of the solvent. One is aqueous solution and non-aqueous solution. Most of the substances is soluble in water. So, it is called as a universal solvent. So, water is called as a universal solvent. Some substances do not dissolve in water. Other solvent examples, ether, benzene, alcohol are used to prepare a solution. On the basis, the type of the solvent, the solution also classified into two types, that is aqueous and non-aqueous solution. It's very easy. Aqueous means the solution in which water is only acts as a solvent, it is called as a aqueous solution. And non-aqueous solution means except water, what are the other solvents or act means, that is called as a non-aqueous solution. I'll be giving you the aqueous solution example is common salt in water, common salt in sugar, copper sulfate in water. So, water which acts as a solvent, it is called as a aqueous solution. In non-aqueous solution, in any liquid other than water is acts as a solvent, it is called a non-aqueous solution. Here also we will be giving you the examples. Sulfur dissolved in carbon disulfate. So, carbon disulfate is a solvent. Iodine dissolved in carbon tetrachloride. So, this is the based on the type of the solvent. We have a picture of sulfur in carbon disulfate and the next picture is sulfur in water. What will happen when sulfur in carbon disulfate? Carbon disulfate is a non-aqueous solution, isn't it? It will dissolve in carbon disulfate. When sulfur is mixed with water, it is insoluble. Okay. So, sulfur is soluble in carbon disulfate. Same sulfur is insoluble in water. The types of the solution is based on the amount of the solute. The amount of the solute that can be dissolved in the given amount of the solvent is limited under given conditions. Based on the amount of the solute, the given amount of solvents solution is classified into three types. Saturated solution, unsaturated solution, supersaturated solution. Now we are going to see the saturated solution. A solution which no more solute can be dissolved in a definite amount of solvent at a given temperature, it is called as a saturated solution. Example, you have to take a 36 grams of NaCl, that is sodium chloride, in 100 grams of water at 25 degrees Celsius, which forms only saturated solution. If you add more NaCl, you are not able to dissolve in it or the solubility will be changes. So 36 grams of NaCl will dissolve in 100 grams of water at 25 degrees Celsius is a saturated solution. So learn what is mean by first saturated solution. If you know very well about a saturated solution only, you can able to understand super saturated as well as unsaturated. Now it is very easy. After saturated solution, what is mean by unsaturated solution? When you put very less amount of solute in it, for example, we already known 36 grams of NaCl dissolve in 100 grams of water. No, so below 36 grams, if you dissolve in 100 grams of water at 25 degrees Celsius, means that is unsaturated solution. Then, what is mean by super saturated solution? Any guesses? Yes. If you put more 36 grams of NaCl in 100 grams of water at 25 degrees Celsius, it means to be a supersaturated solution. So, it's very easy. The saturated solution, unsaturated solution and supersaturated solution. You have a detailed explanation of saturated solution. Below grams if you put means that is a unsaturated solution. If you put a more grams of solute, that is called as a super saturated solution. Now we are going to see the concentrated and dilute solution, which is very easy. Listen to my points. It is another kind of classification of unsaturated solution. In the express of the relative concentrator of the two solution with respect to their solute present in the given amount of solvent. For example, you are given a 2 cup of tea. When you taste them, you can feel one is sweeter than other, isn't it? What do you inferior from it? The tea which is sweet more contains higher amount of sugar than the other, isn't it? If you taste the tea, what will happen? Which will be very sweeter, you will be judging one cup of tea contains higher amount of sugar. So, otherwise, how can you express in the observation? You can say that tea is stronger. So, by the chemist or in a chemistry language, what you will do? That is called as more concentrated. Okay. When we compare two solutions having a same solute and solvent, one of which contains higher amount of solute as a per given amount of solvent, it's said to be a concentrated solution. So, other one is dilute solution. For example, you will have a cup of tea, only 2 spoons of sugar you have to add, that is the equal amount. If you add more than 2 spoons, it is called as a concentrated. Okay. If you add very less than 2 spoons, it is diluted. So, I will give you one easy example. So, it's an example of dilute as well as concentrated solution. Look at the activity. First one is tea, isn't it? The first picture you have a dark tea and the second picture you have a very light color tea. In the second picture you will have a copper sulfate solution which is dark blue and the next one is sky blue in color. Okay. Label them or you just see to it both the solutions. You just guess which is diluted and concentrated. The first tea which will having a dark color, definitely it will be a concentrated, and the next light tea is a diluted because the tea content of a tea will be very light. So, it's only light brown in color which will have a dark color mean concentrated. The next picture when you goes to copper sulfate solution, it's a dark blue in color. If you add more copper sulfate only, you will get a dark blue, isn't it? So, it is a concentrated solution. Dilute solution is a very light blue in color. You can identify the dilute and concentration solution while seeing the picture itself. Next important topic is solubility. Usually there is a limit in amount of solute that can dissolve in given amount of solvent in the given temperature. When this limit is reached, you will be showing that is a saturated solution. And any excess of solute that is added simply the settle down bottom of the solution. The extent of dissolution of the solute in a solvent can be better explained by its solubility. Solubility is a measure how much of solute can be dissolved in a specified amount of solvent. Have a definition of a solubility. It is defined as the number of grams of solute that can dissolve in 100 grams of solvent to form a saturated solution at given temperature and pressure. So, this is the solubility definition. Once again, I am repeating. Solubility is defined as the number of grams of solute that can be dissolved in 100 grams of solvent to form its saturated solution at a given temperature and pressure. For example, 36 grams of NaCl, that is sodium chloride, need to dissolve in 100 grams of water to form a saturated solution. We already seen this, isn't it? Thus, solubility of NaCl is water is 36 gram at 25 degrees Celsius. So, we will have a formula to it. So, solubility is mass of solute divided by mass of solvent into 100. And some more common substances in water at 25 degrees Celsius. So, I having a some more solute also. calcium carbonate. You can note this into your classwork or rough note, okay? Calcium carbonate, the solubility is 0.0013. Sodium chloride, NaCl is 36. This is standard, okay? Ammonia, 46. Sodium hydroxide, 80. Glucose, 91. Sodium bromide, 95. Sodium iodide is 184. Okay, last topic we seen about the solubility, isn't it? So, factors affecting the solubility. What are the factors will affect the solubility? There are three factors which affecting the solubility. One is nature of the solute and solvent. Second one is a temperature. And third one is a pressure. Nature of the solute and the solvent. What does mean by nature of the solute and solvent? While the solution means the definitely of solute and the solvent will play the important role in it, isn't it? So, water dissolves in enormous varieties of substances, both ionic as well as covalent. It does not dissolve in everything. The scientists often use predicting solubility like dissolves like. The expression means by dissolving occurs when similarity exists between the solute and solvent. For example, common salt in the polar compound will dissolve readily in a polar solvent like water. So, effect of temperature, solubility of solids in liquid, solubility of gases in liquid. Solubility of solid solute in liquid decreases or increases. It increases with increase in temperature. So, greater amount of sugar will dissolve in warm water than the cold water. It is an example when you increase the temperature. If you add a 2 spoons of sugar in a hot water, what will happen? It dissolves very easily, isn't it? When you compare to a normal water or a cold water. So, when a temperature is increases, solubility is also increases. In endothermic process, solubility increases with increase in temperature. In exothermic process, solubility decreases with increase in temperature. The next one is solubility of gases in liquid. Do you know why bubbling when water is boiled? Solubility of a gas in liquid decreases with increase in temperature. The water contains dissolved oxygen, isn't it? When water is heated, the solubility of oxygen in water is decreases. So, oxygen escapes in the form of bubbles. Aquatic animals live more in cold water. Oftenly asking this question. So, please remember this question. Why aquatic animals is more comfortable in cold water? More amount of dissolved oxygen is present in a cold water. So, the solubility of oxygen in water is more at lower temperature. So, that's why the aquatic animals live more in cold water. Third one is effect of pressure. Effect of pressure is observed only in the case of solubility of gas in a liquid. When a pressure is increased, the solubility of the gas of the liquid is also increased. Some example I am going to say is soft drinks, household cleaners, container aqueous solution of ammonia, aqueous solution of formaldehyde, etc. It is a effect pressure on solubility. Henry's law. It is also one more important topic or definition is meant to be asked regularly. The effect of pressure on the solubility of gas in a liquid is given by a Henry's law. It states that a solubility of a gas in a liquid is directly proportional to the pressure of the gas over the solution at definite temperature. This law was created by Henry. That's why this law is named as a Henry's law. Concentration of a solution. So far we discussed what is meant by solution, isn't it? Most of the chemical reactions takes place in a solution form. So, essential to qualify the solute in solvent, it's a study of the reaction. To qualify the solute in a solution, we can use a term is called as a concentration. Concentration of the solution may be defined as the amount of solute present in the given amount of solvent or solution. Mass percentage. Mass percentage of the solution is defined as the percentage by mass of the solute present in the solution. So, mass percentage formula is mass of the solute divided by mass of the solution into 100. The mass of the solution, maybe you can write as the mass of the solute plus mass of the solvent. This is the definition of the mass percentage. Next one is volume percentage. Volume percentage is defined as the percentage by the volume of the solute present in the given volume. The volume percentage is definition is volume of the solute divided by volume of the solution into 100. You can notice that the commercial product that we come across in daily life like syrup, mouthwash, antiseptic lotions, household disinfectants. The concentrated ingredients is expressed in the V by V. In this picture also you can able to see W by W, isn't it? Similarly, in ointments and antiseptic soaps and concentrated solutions are expressed as W by W. In some they will be written as a V by V, and some cases or some ointments and antiseptic soaps you can see that W by W. Hydrated salt and water of crystallization. When ionic substances are dissolved in water, to make the saturated aqueous solution, the ion attracts water molecules, which then attack chemically in certain ratio. The process is called as a hydration. These ionic substances crystallize out from the saturated aqueous solution with a definite number of molecules of water. The number of water molecules are found in crystalline substances. That is called as a water of crystallization. Such salts are called as a hydrated salt. And hydrated salt, common name, IUPAC name and molecular formula. Blue vitriol, copper 2 sulfate pentahydrate, CuSO4.25H2O. Ipsum salt, magnesium sulfate heptahydrate MgSO4.7H2O. Gypsum, calcium sulfate dihydrate CaSO4.2H2O. Green vitriol, iron 2 sulfate heptahydrate FeSO4.7H2O. White vitriol, zinc sulfate heptahydrate ZnSO4.7H2O. These are the hydrated salt, IUPAC and common name on the molecular formula. Now we are going to see the blue vitriol. Blue vitriol means copper sulfate pentahydrate, CuSO4.H2SO. The number of water molecules in the blue vitriol is 5. So, water of crystallization is also 5. When blue copper sulfate crystals is gently heated, it will lost 5 water molecules and become white in color. You can able to notice that the blue color while heating, it will become white. Ipsum salt, that is magnesium sulfate heptahydrate MgSO4.7H2O. Its water of crystallization is 7 because 7H2O, no? So, when magnesium sulfate heptahydrate crystallize, gently heated, it lost 7 water molecules and become anhydrous magnesium sulfate. If you add few drops of water, allow it to cool, the colorless anhydrous salt again turns into a hydrated salt. So, it is a reversible reaction. When magnesium sulfate heptahydrate will become a anhydrate magnesium sulfate. Hydroscopy. Certain substances when exposed to atmosphere at ordinary temperature which absorb the moisture without changing their any physical state, that substances is called as a hydroscopic substances. Here, hydroscopic substances are used for drying agent, example concentrated sulfuric acid, phosphorus pentoxide, quick lime and silica gel. The next one is deliquescence. Certain substances which are so hydroscopic, when exposed to the atmosphere in ordinary temperature, absorb enough water and gets completely dissolved. Such substances is called as a deliquent substances, and this property is called as a deliquescent. These substances lost a crystal shape, ultimately dissolved in absorbed water forming saturated solution. You can see the picture in it. Deliquescent in a sodium hydroxide. It's deliquescent in a maximum when temperature is low, atmospheric is humid. So example of this is caustic soda NaOH, caustic potash is KOH, and ferric chloride is FeCl3. And the last topic is difference between hydroscopic substance and deliquescent substances. Hydroscopic substance, when exposed to the atmosphere in ordinary temperature, they absorb the moisture and no changes in a physical and do not dissolve also. In deliquescent substances, it exposed to the atmosphere in ordinary temperature, they absorb the moisture and dissolve. In hydroscopic substances, do not change in any physical state. In deliquescent substances, they will change its physical state in an exposure of air. Hydroscopic substances may be a anomalous solid or liquid. Deliquescent substances are crystalline solids. These are the difference between hydroscopic substance as well as deliquescent substance. Now we are going to see the important, that is problems. Now we are going to see the problems based on the solubility as well as percentage by mass and volume. The first problem is based on only the solubility. Okay. 1.5 grams of solute dissolve in 15 grams of water to form a saturated solution at 298 Kelvin. Find the solubility of the solution. What is the formula of the solubility of the solution? Mass of the solute divided by mass of the solvent into 100. You can find it out in the question, what is solvent and what is solute? Water is solvent, isn't it? So 15 grams of water is a solvent. In question itself, they gave you 1.5 grams of solute. So solute is a 1.5 grams. So you have to write mass of the solute is 1.5 gram and mass of the solvent is 15 grams. So you have to substitute in the formula. The solubility of the solute is 1.5 divided by 15 into 100, you will get 10 grams. Let's move on to the second question. Find the mass of potassium chloride could be needed to form a saturated solution in 60 grams of water at 303 Kelvin. Okay. The mass of potassium chloride in 100 grams of water of saturated solution is 37. They itself gave you in the question, isn't it? So mass of the potassium chloride in 60 grams of water in saturated solution is 37 divided by 100 into 60 grams. So after cancelling each zeros and it can goes in two tables, after dividing you will get at 22.2 grams. Third question. What is the mass of sodium chloride could be needed to form a saturated solution of 50 grams of water in 30 degrees Celsius? We all know that in sodium chloride, 36 grams of sodium chloride is a saturated solution, isn't it? So, at 30 degrees Celsius, 36 grams of sodium chloride dissolve in 100 grams of water. Therefore, mass of sodium chloride that could be needed 100 grams of water is 36. So you have to write the formula is mass of the sodium chloride in 100 grams, not it is a 50 gram. So 36 into 50 divided by 100, you will get 18 grams. Fourth question. The solubility of a sodium nitrate at 50 degrees Celsius and 30 degrees Celsius in 114 grams and 96 grams respectively. Find the amount of salt that will thrown out When saturated solution of sodium nitrate containing 50 grams of water is cooled from 50 degrees Celsius to 30 degrees Celsius. So, amount of sodium nitrate dissolved in 100 grams of water at 50 degrees Celsius is 114. So, amount of sodium nitrate dissolved in 50 grams, so 114 into 50 divided by 100. So, 51s are 50, 52s are 100. 114 divided by 2 is 56 grams. Then, similarly, amount of sodium nitrate dissolved. So, 96 is sodium nitrate into 50 grams divided by 100. So, 51s are 50, 52s are 100. So, 96 divided by 2, you will get a 46 grams. Okay. So, total, what you will have? The amount of sodium nitrate throw from 50 grams of water cooled to 50 degrees Celsius to 30 degrees Celsius. No, so, you have to subtract. So, 57 grams minus 46 grams, you will get 9 grams as an answer. The next problem is based on the mass percentage. You will have three problems in it. The first problem is the mass percentage formula is mass of the solute divided by mass of the solution into 100. Solutions are prepared by dissolving 26 grams of sugar in 100 grams of water. So, calculate the mass of the percentage. You have to find out what is mean by solute and what is mean by solvent. Solute is a water. So, already they gave you 100 grams of water. So, it is a solvent. Solute, it's a sugar. So, 25 grams. So, substitute in the formula. Mass percentage is mass of the solute divided by mass of the solute plus mass of the solvent. So, mass of the solute is 25 divided by mass of the solute again is 25. Plus mass of the solvent is 100 into 100. You should not supposed to cancel 100, okay? Remember that. 25 divided by 125, okay? Now only you can able to cancel 125 and 100. You can cancel in a 25 table. So, 25 fours are 100, 25 fives are 125. So, you can again you can make it a cancel. 25 fours are means 100 divided by 25. 100 divided by 5. So, that is 5 ones are 5, 5 twenties are 100. You can able to cancel and you will get answer is 20%. Second and third question. Second question. 16 grams of NaCl dissolved in 100 grams of water at 25 degrees Celsius to form a saturated solution. Find the mass percentage of solvent and solute. Mass of the solute is 16 grams, isn't it? So, already they gave you 100 grams of water. That is a solvent. So, first we are going to calculate the mass percentage of solute and then we are going for the mass percentage of the solvent. First, mass percentage of the solute. Mass of the solute divided by mass of the solute plus mass of the solvent into 100. Mass of the solute. What is the mass of the solute? 16. Mass of the solute plus mass of the solvent in the denominator is 16 plus 100 into 100. So, 16 into 100 divided by 16 plus 100 is 116. After cancelling, you will get a 13.79%. Mass percentage of the solvent is equal to 100, isn't it? So, mass percentage of the solute is 100 minus 13.79. So, you will get answer of 86.21%. The third question is, find the amount of urea which is to be dissolved in water to get a 500 grams of 10% V by V aqueous solution. So, mass percentage formula is mass of the solute divided by mass of the solution into 100. They didn't give a mass of the solute, that is mass of urea. They gave the mass percentage is 10%. So, substitute in a 10 is equal to mass of the urea. They didn't give you. So, we have to find out the mass of the urea divided by mass of the solution. Mass of the solution is 500. Okay. So, you can make a cancel of these two. 100 ones are 100, 100 fives are. This 5 will goes to the equal to sign that side. So, 10 into 5, that is 50. So, mass of the urea is equal to 50 grams. The next is problems based on the volume-volume percentage. Solution is made up of 35 ml of methanol and 65 ml of water. Calculate the volume percentage. It's very easy. The what is meant by the volume percentage formula? Volume of the solute divided by volume of the solution into 100. So, volume of the solute 35 divided by volume of the solvent plus volume of the solute. So, 35 plus 65, that is 100 into 100. You can cancel both the 100 when the denominator and the numerator. You will get 35% as a answer. Second question. Calculate the volume of ethanol in 200 ml of solution in 20 grams of V by V aqueous solution of ethanol. Volume of aqueous solution they already gave us 200 ml. Volume percentage also they gave you as 20%. What is the formula? Volume percentage is equal to volume of the solute divided by volume of the solution into 100. Volume percentage only they already gave you. The question itself, it's a 20%. So, substitute 20 equal to volume of the ethanol, that is we are going to calculate. Volume of the solution, total solution, that is aqueous solution they gave you. No, aqueous solution means solute as well as solvent. 200 into 100, isn't it? So, you can cancel these 100 ones are 100, 100 twos are 200. This 2 will go to the equal to sign, equal to opposite it will go means it will becomes as a multiplication. So 20 into 2, that is 40 ml. So volume of ethanol is 40 ml. From this our solution lesson gets over. It is a damn easiest lesson in the chemistry. So we can more concentrate in definitions, like 2 marks like in the problem sums. Work out the problems daily. Thank you, children. What is mean by deliquescent? What is mean by solubility? And problem sums, definitely you should go through. All the sums you should go through and memorize the formulas. And at last, you should put the unit for the answer. So, thank you, children. Make this video as a utilized video. So, make the video as a utilized one. And you should put a unit also for this formulas. Write the formula, substitute the formula and write the answer with the unit. Definitely, you will get a 2 marks. So, you will have at least 10 to 12 problems in it. So, work all the problems daily. Go through this lesson continuously. Not only this lesson, the past videos, lessons and all, you have to go through it. So I think you can utilize this video. It's very easiest lesson. Thank you, children.